In this video, we're going to find out how to use our favorite pieces of external hardware and even things like guitar pedals inside of our Cubase projects. Let's check it out. Hey guys, it's Steve from Featherlight, and in this video, we're going to go step by step and learn how to use our favorite pieces of external analog hardware and even things like guitar pedals inside of our Cubase projects. And we're going to learn how to deal with the latency and all the stuff that that's going to incur. Now, Cubase already comes with some amazing effects to choose from, and there's plenty of stuff to keep your creative juices flowing. But there's something different about using external hardware, just because it's completely different. A lot of it might be analog, it might have a completely different set of mojo, it might be things you're used to working with in past projects, or it might have just the vibe you're looking for. So we're going to figure out how to actually connect them and use them inside of our Cubase projects. Let's check it out. First, to make this setup work, we're going to need an audio interface that has more than just two channels in and two channels out, because we're going to need those additional channels to make the patch from the digital world out to the analog world and then back into our audio interface. This doesn't need to be a lot of extra channels, but it does need to at least be one additional channel in and out for mono sources and two additional channels in and out for stereo sources. So for this example, let's start at the very beginning of a project with some raw drum tracks. The project sounds like this. All right, so these are raw drum tracks that were done a couple days ago as a room test, and we want to start adding some mojo to just the snare sound. We could simply just go up to studio in our audio connections, and we could create a bus, an output bus. We'll leave it at mono, and we'll just call this snare send for the time being. Okay, we add the bus, and then let's choose where it's going to go out our audio interface. Now, our audio interface has 16 outputs to choose from. Yours might have less. It might have only 4 or 8 or whatever. Unlike some other DAWs, Cubase will allow you any combination of ins and outs to create a hardware loop. But for simplicity's sake, it really helps to keep those things in line. So if you go out 5, come back in 5. If you go out 11, come back in 11. So our snare sound is going to go out our physical output number 5 of our audio interface. It's going to travel down the wire, and it's going to go into the input of our effects device. Then we take another cable, we plug it into the output of the effects device, and we go back into our audio interface, in this case channel 5, and make the complete loop. If your audio interface offers what are known as insert jacks, you can do this entire loop with one cable. The cable is known as an insert cable. It has a stereo connection on one side, and then 2 quarter-inch connections on the other side. The insert goes into the insert jack, and the other two connectors go into the input and the output of the effects device, completing the entire loop. And you may also need some adapters depending on your external hardware style of connections. Next, we go to our snare that we're going to affect. We go down to direct routing, and instead of sending it to the snare bus in the project, we send it to the hardware out we just created. From here, we create another channel in our DAW. We set the input up to match the loop channel that we just created. That's number 5 on our audio interface. We arm the track, and we simply record the result. And because we're using real hardware, this process has to be done in real time. We have to play back our audio in real time in our project and let the entire signal path occur naturally and come back into our audio interface. So this method works fine, and now we have a snare sound that we're happy with. And we've printed our external effect. Everything sounds great, except one major drawback is that this requires you to commit to that sound. We don't get to tweak it along the way. We don't get to play with the effect as the mix evolves and changes and then arrive at something later. Whatever we print, we're stuck with, and that's not going to work at this stage of the project because all mixes change over time. So thankfully, Cubase gives us a very clever way to treat this whole loop process. It's important to note that in the following examples, we'll be using features found only in the Cubase Pro version, not artist elements or lower. So the first thing we're going to do is go back up to our snare top. That's the one that was going out to the effect. We had the direct routing going out that send that we had created. We're going to cancel that, and we're going to send it back to our regular snare bus instead. Then we're going to come up to studio, down to audio connections, and we're going to remove that snare send. That's the physical bus or hardware output that we created so we could make that loop. We're going to go ahead and remove that. You'll see these tabs along the top here. This is our output section, our input section. And then we have things like group effects, external instruments, control room. We're going to click on external effects. And we're going to click on Add External Effects. And this little dialog window pops up. We're going to name this the name of the effect. So this is going to be our Blackline 1176. That's going to be the name of our external effect. We can create a mono or stereo send. So if we wanted to send two channels of information out to our effects device and then have two return channels, we could do that. But because this is a mono effects device, we're going to have a mono send and a mono return. Now, we could have a mono send and a stereo return, like if sending a mono signal into maybe a reverb or something like that. But for the time being, we're going to keep these both at mono since our effect is mono. Once we've named our send and created a stereo or mono version of it, it's time to set up the inputs and outputs. So our send bus, that's going to be where it's going, is going to go out our audio interface's number 5 output. And just like in our previous example, we're going to set the return bus up so that it comes back on our audio interface's number 5 input. If those inputs and outputs are used elsewhere in the project, you might see this dialog box. What this dialog box is telling us is if that port is used in any other part of the project, this is going to replace those connections. Up here, we have some additional controls as well. We can display the latency, although this is an analog loop, so no measurable amount of latency. And we can change the send and return gain to the device as well here. So this means that if, for example, our gain staging into the effects device is a little weak, maybe the effects isn't calibrated the same as a regular gear, maybe it's minus 10 versus plus 4, whatever, we can account for some of that gain. For the time being, we're going to leave it at 0. The same thing on the return. We can set this up to be hotter or quieter. So this just gives us a method to account for different gain staging on the way out and on the way back in. If we currently go up to Studio, and then we go down to our Plugin Manager, there is our brand new effects. So this is going to be treated like an actual plugin, like any other plugin in our system. We're simply going to drag it into our compressor list, and we can choose it just like a regular compressor. So here's our snare track right here. Let's go up to Inserts now, and let's insert that onto the actual track. So come down to here, we'll come down to compressors, and there's our brand new plugin that we just created, only this is a real piece of hardware. So here's our brand new plugin interface. From here, we can even click on the measure delay button and ping the entire round trip process to see if there's any delay, and Cubase takes care of all of that in the background for us, neat and tidy. And now when we play back our source, there's our external analog piece of hardware acting on our live input for our snare in real time. It is important that after we're done at the end of our mix and we've achieved the exact sound that we want, if we don't want to have to do this in real time, because remember, if we mix down at this stage, our mix down has to be in real time to include any of those external hardware effects that we're using, like this plugin here. If we wanted to continue to work but not have that loop active any longer, or we needed those inputs for something else, we could come up to Snare, come up to Edit, come up to Render in Place. Here our Render Tracks dialog box opens up and it gives us all the choices that are available. We want to choose Render as Channel Settings because we want our channel settings to be intact here. We don't need the entire signal path because we're going to continue to work, but the channel settings needs to be selected in order to include that real-time render. Once the render process is started, like we said before, it takes the entire length of the song for that to complete. Once the process is done, Cubase renders the entire track. It automatically mutes our top snare, the original part, and it enables our brand new, freshly printed snare track with the effects intact. From here, we got the best of both worlds. We have the original track that we could continue to tweak if need be, or we could use the printed track and save the resources. In this next example, we're going to be using another piece of outboard gear in a rack, but this time we're going to be using a digital effects device. And this has some additional considerations that we need to understand to use it. So let's check it out. So first, we're going to come up to Studio, Audio Connections, and we see our pre-existing one that we've just finished. We're going to add another one. This particular one, we're going to be using our TC Electronics M1. And this is still one of the best Tom's reverbs ever made. Dense, lush, it sounds great. And we want to be able to use this in our productions. So we're going to title this TC M1. And we're going to be sending a mono send to it from our audio interface, but we're going to be using a stereo return. We want all the stereo effects of it. When we create it, we see our new device and our two send and return configuration windows open up here. We're going to be using output number 6 on our audio interface for the send. And since most of our inputs are spoken for on this mix setup already, we're going to return the effects into channels 11 and 12. Thankfully, Cubase allows us to mismatch our patch setup. Although, like we mentioned before, if possible, it's always best to keep them aligned. If we're setting up a bunch of these, it's really handy to be able to save them as presets. So if we hit the Favorites tab, we can actually add the selected TCM1 to our favorites list. This is very handy as we can recall them or remove them as needed, and it's just a presets list that allows us not to have to set these up every single time you want to use this if they're the same configurations. From here, we can click out of the window, we come up to Studio, come down to Plugin Manager. This particular arrangement that you see is our custom collection, but if you're using the default collection here, you'll see that it has its own category for external plugins. Click on it, we'll see both the ones we just added here. We're gonna go back to our custom one for the time being. Here's TCM1, and we wanna put it in our reverb collection here. So we're gonna drag this over. Then it's in our custom reverb collection, ready to use. Let's head on over to the console. And because we want to use this as an effects return bus and not just a group channel or use it as an insert, we're going to create an effects track specifically for it. We're going to come down and we're going to choose the new effect that we just created. That's the TCM1. We're going to leave the configuration stereo. We're going to leave the audio outputs to our masters, which is 15 and 16 on our audio interface. And then we're going to title this TCM1 Verb. All right, we add the track, and then this window pops up like it did before, but because we're not using analog equipment, which basically has no measurable delay, this one will, because it's a digital effects device, which means it has its own analog to digital converters in the unit itself, and there's no way for Cubase to know what that will be. So we hit the measure delay button so we can find out. It pings the device and tells us that there's 2.05 milliseconds induced as latency as a round trip for this. This is important because Cubase needs that information to be able to correctly compensate for the latency. We've relocated the effects bus over to the right side of the project where all the other buses are, just to keep things neat and tidy, and we're ready to add some effects to the toms track. So let's come up to the toms channel, go to the sends, we'll power on the send, get some playback going, and hear what we got. So as usual, the TC sounds great and we can treat it like any other VST effect in our system. Now it's time to move on and start using some more interesting things like guitar pedals. Pedals are a great way to add some vibe and mojo to your project, especially if they're unique and don't sound like a lot of other kinds of effects, like this Memory Boy from Electro-Harmonix has a very unique kind of quality and sound to it. However, when using guitar pedals inside your audio productions, there are some special considerations that set them apart from every other kind of external hardware that we need to take into account before we patch them into our digital audio world. All the external gear we've used up till this point has been known as line level gear, which means its outputs are quite hot. However, guitar pedals are made to work with guitars, and guitars have very low output levels. This difference is known as impedance. You've probably heard that term before, and if you get this wrong, the impedance will affect the tone of your instrument and could even potentially damage some pedals as the signal going into them is actual voltage. So to fix that, we need to add an additional step to our signal path process, and that's to use what's known as a reamp box. Now, I've done a complete and in-depth studio session on the process of reamping, and you guys can check that out on the cards here above, but the long and short of it is this. A reamp box takes the signal that's coming out of your audio interface, which is line level and very hot, and converts it back into the impedance that a guitar pedal or an amplifier expects to see. So to make this connection, we're going to go out our audio interface's output number 2. We're going to go into the input of the reamp box, out of the reamp box's output, into the input of the Memory Boy. From there, the output of the Memory Boy goes back into our audio interface channel's number 2. And the reason why is because this number 2 channel offers what's known as a high Z switch. This switch is found on most modern day audio interfaces, and it lets the interface know that we're going to be sending it a low ohmage output that our pedals produce instead of the high output that our line level gear produces. That keeps our impedance correct all through the signal path, and it protects our pedals as well. So we're inside of Cubase. This is a new project. It's kind of a Spanish flamenco style guitar, and we want to add some delay to it. So first thing we're going to do is come up to Studio, choose Audio Connections, navigate over to External Effects tab, and choose Add External Effects. From here, we're going to call our Memory Boy for simplicity's sake just MB, and our configurations are in mono. We have a mono send and a mono return. That makes things nice and easy. Now to set up where our send and returns are going to go, Our send is going to be going out audio interface channel 2, and our return is going to be coming back on audio interface channel 2 as well. Channels 1 and 2 are the two channels on our audio interface that feature that high Z input. This way, all the impedance is matched correctly through the entire loop signal path. From here, we come down to Plugin Manager, and since we have a custom collection of effects, we need to put this inside of a category. So we're going to find the newly created effects we just made. That's MB. We're going to put it down here in our external pedals category. From here, we simply go back to the channel, navigate up to our effects, come down to external pedals like we did before, and there's our plugin. We're basically good to go. Because this is an analog loop in and out, there really isn't any measurable delay. So even if we hit this, it still returns zero. And we're ready to use our new VST effect. The Memory Boy is an analog delay style pedal, and it's unique in that when you move the delay knob, you can actually hear that analog delay speed up and slow down until it syncs with the new delay tempo. And that gives it a very analog and kind of organic sound that we can play with as we increase the delay. All right, so there's some examples about how you can integrate your own hardware into your Cubase projects and add a whole new layer of creativity and inspiration to it. Hey, if you found this was helpful or if you learned something, please hit the subscription and notification bells. It really does help keep the channel going. Thanks for hanging out with me today. I really appreciate it. Stay safe, be creative, add something creative to the world. We'll catch you guys in the next video.